Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to welcome you to Westminster Presbyterian Church's online worship service today. My name is Adam Rogers and I am the pastor here at the church, and I'm so glad you are joining us today. I am thankful that you've chosen to gather with our faith community in praise and worship of God and to hear a holy word from God for your life. I know you could have picked any church's online worship video, but you chose ours today, and I'm thankful for that. You know, we have three different ways you can worship on a Sunday morning right now. We have a modified sanctuary service, a parking lot service, and of course, this video. And all three of these are a reflection of our church's larger mission, which is to meet and accept people wherever they are on their spiritual journey. So thanks again today for joining us. We really appreciate it, and we appreciate you. And if you like our videos online, please share them with others so that they might have the opportunity to enjoy them as well. Now, I need to share something before we get on with the rest of today's worship service. I want to remind you that our director of music, Kathy Miller, has departed our church, and we're now in a season of transition as we begin the search for a new music director. During this season, though, you'll notice that our online worship videos are not going to have the special music and hymn singing by our choir members that you've come to appreciate in recent weeks. I know you're going to miss them, and so am I. But even as we grieve Kathy's departure, could I ask you to do something today? Could you spend some time in prayer, asking God to guide our church through this season of transition? And may we trust that God, even now, is at work preparing the next leader of our church's music ministry. Thank you for your prayers. You know, I've been your pastor now for 2 years, and in that time, we have had 6 staff positions go through seasons of transition, which is a lot of change. It's a lot of disruption to a staff of a church. Yet in each instance, when we were in that moment where we thought, who are we going to get to replace this person or that person? Each time God has pulled through and called the right person for the job. Now, I know God will do the same thing again in this season as we search for our next music director. Let us take hope and comfort in that. Now, brothers and sisters, let's continue with our worship service today. For children of God, welcome home. Come, let us worship God. Brothers and sisters, let us now take our joys and concerns and all of our lives to God in prayer. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, creator of all things, good and bountiful, as we move into the unknown experiences of this new day which you have made, be our steady companion and guide, and help us to rejoice and be glad, for we know it's a privilege to be alive today and have the opportunity to live into being the people you call us to be. God of hope and healing, you promise that in the midst of suffering, you will always be present. We pray that all who suffer in any way, whether through illness, injury, poverty, or hunger, homelessness, addiction, violence, or grief, be especially aware of your sustaining presence and be encouraged by your love to persevere these days. For God, so many places in our country and throughout the world continue to struggle with the coronavirus pandemic. So we pray for healing for those who are ill. We pray for comfort for those who mourn and wisdom for those who lead, asking especially for your special presence to be with all medical personnel and all essential workers who are so tired but continue to press on and to work hard to serve their communities. Support them. Give them strength for this journey. But help us, God, also as a country in this season to heal divisions, to build up trust among neighbors, to listen and learn from each other so that we all may work together for the common good. For God, in facing conflicts, not just in our communities and in this country, but in our own lives, we pray that you remove bitterness and resentment from our hearts, that you keep us from ever returning evil for evil. Help us instead to overcome evil with love and with goodness, and when the way before us seems closed, and we don't know what our next step should be, lighten our darkness, Lord. Make the path plain before us, and let us walk beside you with trust and confidence and joy. For we ask all of this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our first Bible reading this morning is from Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 through 20. Then the Lord God said, It's not good that the human is alone. I will make him a helper that is perfect for him. So the Lord God formed from the fertile land all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky and brought them to the human to see what he would name them. The human gave each living being its name. The human named all the livestock, all the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals, but a helper perfect for him was nowhere to be found. Our second reading is from Romans chapter 12, verses 10 through 13. Love each other like the members of your family. Be the best at showing honor to each other. Don't hesitate to be enthusiastic. Be on fire in the Spirit as you serve the Lord. Be happy in your hope. Stand your ground when you're in trouble and devote yourselves to prayer. Contribute to the needs of God's people and welcome strangers into your home. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, good morning. Once again, I am continuing this series of sermons called Confessions of Your Pastor. I've shared quite a bit at this point in this sermon series, but I have two more confessions that I still get to make. And I'm going to share a bit of an illustration before I get to today's confession. But even before that, would you please pray with me? Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable unto you, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, 2 years ago, in the summer of 2018, I began serving here as your pastor. And before I even arrived, I had some colleagues who offered me some practical advice that on how I should relocate to a new church. Now, I suppose I really didn't understand or maybe appreciate their advice until I moved. Most of all, I had no idea how hard it was going to be to follow one of their suggestions, which was to make some friends outside of the congregation. Now, they told me that I would need a community beyond that of the church. Now, that seemed like straightforward, helpful advice, seemed obvious enough, but having lived in this area for 2 years now, I am just about at a loss on how adults are supposed to make friends when they move into a neighborhood as an outsider. Now, for me, the church, which is for many people often a place to meet friends and to form fellowship opportunities, for me, the church is both my workplace and faith community. And so how do I turn to this place to make friends? Or where do I turn beyond the church for friendships? You know, I've joined the Y, and I appreciate going there, but when I go to the Y, I'm there to swim or to exercise, and so I don't really have much time or energy or enthusiasm for conversation with other people who are there. I thought about joining a book club, but I already lead a book club here at the church. Do I take some kind of class outside of the church? They don't sound like bad ideas, but here's the real truth. Most days, by the time I get to the end of the day, I am too exhausted to summon the emotional energy that's needed to navigate a new social situation. You know, this kind of navigation is what I do all day, every day, as the pastor here at the church. Now, don't get me wrong, I love being the pastor here at this church. I love serving WPC. You are wonderful, and you are loving, and you are kind, and after 2 years together, you still go out of your way to help make this transition as your pastor a joy and a privilege. But even 2 years in, learning this new place, learning this church, learning your stories and who you are takes everything that I have in a given week. And so when I get home, quite frankly, I don't have anything left. Which leads me to today's confession as a part of this sermon series, which is this. Sometimes I get lonely. Now, in today's Bible reading from Genesis, we are told that when God created the world, he declared that everything he created to be good. The sun, the earth, the moon, the stars, all of it good. He created the animals and was pleased with them. He created the mountains and the oceans and the trees. And then he says, and it was good. Above all, God was most proud of his best work, which was the human that he called man. All was good, we are told, except for one thing. We're told the Lord God said, it's not good for man to be alone. You see, loneliness was what made God's good creation imperfect. This was a problem that God fixed by doubling his creation from one person to two. God designed us, you see, to need each other. And so if it's not
good for us to be alone. Here's the question I struggle with. Why do I feel lonely so much of the time? You know, loneliness is a weird thing. Because if you're like me, you can stand in a crowd of people and still feel alone. You can have people who know you, but still are very far from your heart. You can be the focus of people's attention and still feel emotionally bankrupt. You know, I find myself susceptible to loneliness because of my position as a pastor of a church, which can be a very lonely way to make a living. Often I find myself asking these questions like, you know, I'm supposed to be here for everyone else in this church, but what happens when I am hurting? What happens when I'm afraid, or when I need acceptance, or when I feel alone? Who ministers to me? Where do I go for companionship? Now, I know I'm not the only one who struggles with these feelings of loneliness. I have seen and talked with married couples and married individuals who are aching for intimacy. I've talked with kids who are craving real friendships beyond social media. I've talked with teenagers who are battling feelings of isolation during this pandemic season. There are countless single adults who long for long-term committed relationships and companionships. There are many older people, even here in our congregation, especially throughout this pandemic, who are struggling with feelings of being abandoned and forgotten. And there are leaders. I have colleagues who seem like they have it all together, but often are struggling with a loneliness within their souls. And I think God hates all of this, because we know that God has hated it since the beginning of creation, that it is not good for us to be alone. This idea, this pushback against loneliness, pours out from the very heartbeat of God, who deeply values relationships. For God wants us to know Him. God wants us to be in relationship with Him. And we come to know God more by sharing His love with each other through relationships. But even though God wants us to connect intimately with God, but also with each other, many of us still struggle with thoughts like, you know, does anyone really care about me? If I died, would anyone even notice? Would it matter to anyone? No one really knows or understands the real me. And even if they did, and maybe especially if they did, I know they wouldn't like me. Now, I know about you, but, well, I don't know about you, but I know at least for me, there are feelings of loneliness that confuse me at times. And amidst my confusion, I get disoriented, and sometimes I fall into some traps, some dangerous mindsets. First of all, I fall into the trap of feeling like I need to perform for people. I think, you know, if I don't perform for people the way the pastor should be, or be acting, maybe they're going to reject me as the pastor, which is not something I really need right now. So I think, you know, I better really do my job well. I better work hard or work harder. I better not say or do anything that might, you know, ruffle people's feathers, especially now when everybody's living with such heightened anxiety about so many things in our climate these days. I think maybe I should keep my opinions to myself or keep them to a minimum. Don't rock the boat. Be the pastor they want you to be, or who you want me to be, even if it's sometimes different from the person I feel like I really am. Second, I fall into this trap of struggling to trust people. Maybe you felt that way. You know, to make it in this world, we say, you know what? I gotta always be on my guard. People really aren't who they say they are. Eventually, they're just gonna let you down and disappoint you. And so you have to walk through this world protecting yourself. Keep people at arm's length. Don't trust them, or you're gonna get burned. And so we build up these walls, and we don't let anyone really inside. But we know that this also leads to isolation and loneliness. And third, on my most cynical days, I fall into a trap where I just say, you know what? People are selfish. They don't really care about me. They never have and they never will. People only want what's good for them. Your well-being or my well-being is meaningless to those around us. They might say that they like me or that they're praying for me, but it's just a show. It's just an act that people don't really care about me. This is, I really admit, a dangerous trap to fall into because it hardens our hearts. It drives people further away from us, maybe even driving us away from relationships that could be genuine and fruitful and renew our faith in the goodness of people. Now these traps, they are out there in this world. They are traps I fall into at times, and they throw us into a vicious cycle of behavior and thinking. And here's how it works, because this is how I've experienced it to be. You know, because we're lonely, because we're craving relationships with other people, we eventually muster up the courage to, you know, sort of step out and seek out relationships or friendships with people. But even as we do that, we still carry around this painful baggage of damaged relationships of the past, friendships that have fallen apart. And so we enter into these new relationships trying to trust people, trying to open up, trying to take relational risks, but it's just still hard. We're afraid to trust people fully and to really risk doing some things. And so what happens is we enter into these relationships kind of on the wrong foot. We believe that since people really might not like the real me or the real us, we create a fake version of ourselves. We want to perform for people. You know, we want to put on the best show that we have. And it works for a while. We do impress people with our seemingly great lives that we know really aren't that great. Or maybe we go into debt buying things we don't need so that we can impress people that we might not really even like, but we so desperately want them to like us and to accept us and to welcome us into the fold of friendships. You know, maybe it's all about making the grade or scoring more points with people or saying the right thing. Whatever we do, though, we're still just performing. But then we get tired of performing. We start to believe that no one is really going to get to know the real me. And even though we're around people all the time, what happens is we find ourselves still living in solitary confinement. Because still, the real us isn't out there. We hide in our shell. We live with the illusion of safety, with the illusion of friendships. But in reality, we're straight back to feeling isolated and lonely again. And around, the cycle goes. So we're busy, but we're still disconnected. Our relationships are several, but they're superficial. Our brains and our hearts claim to be overwhelmed, but still at the bottom of this, we're painfully lonely. And so how do we fight this feeling of isolation in this lonely world, in this isolated world that we're in? Maybe more importantly, how does God come into this and help us with our loneliness? And where does the local church factor into this? Well, as I ask these questions, well, this is the point in the sermon where everything comes to a crashing halt. Because I have to also confess today that I don't know how to answer these questions. You know, I know we're programmed to expect a sermon to have two parts. The first part has the tension or the problem or the conflict laid out before us. But then we get to the second part where I give you the biblical solution to the problem, so that by the time we get to the end of the sermon, the conflict and the tension has been resolved and we can feel relieved a little bit. But that's not what's going to happen today in the sermon. Because I don't know, I have the answer. And maybe that's okay. Maybe that's okay at least for today. Because the reality is, if you entered into this worship service feeling lonely, if you began this sermon feeling lonely like I do at times, well, you're likely still going to carry that feeling of loneliness with you when the sermon and the worship service is over. That's just how it goes, right? But I don't want to end our time together on a completely hopeless note. None of us need more of that right now, right? And so I want us to turn to Psalm 68 for a minute, because there's this glimmer of hope in the midst of this psalm today. There's this beautiful line in verse 6 that says this: God sets the lonely in families. I was reading that and it gave me pause this week. Isn't that a beautiful declaration of faith? A declaration that God sets the lonely in families. It should be comforting to know that this feeling of loneliness isn't new. It's also comforting to know that God's redemption for our lives includes salvation from its deepest form, which is isolation from God and also from each other. So I want to celebrate that today, that little glimmer of hope in Psalm 68. Now again, I don't have the answer to the cure for loneliness, but I do trust that even as I struggle with loneliness, that God's heart is for the lonely to be set in meaningful relationships. And I'm convinced that God wants to use the church to be a part of that solution, to be a blessing to people's lives. For I believe the church is a place where there is always room for one more. It's a place where we can call each other brother and sister and mean it. It's a place where we can share good news with each other that is very personal, but it's never meant to be private. On our best days as a church, I believe we can encourage and challenge and support one another. And in an American culture that right now idolizes individualism, the church has the opportunity to offer an alternative view of the world that values community. You know, loneliness is real for so many of us. And I don't think it's going to go away very easily. But we, as the church, may we see this and be reminded that this is an opportunity by God's grace to embody what we read in Romans chapter 12. It's what I read to you earlier. And I want to read to you it now again. For it says this: love each other like the members of your family. Be the best at showing honor to each other. Don't hesitate to be enthusiastic. Be on fire in the Spirit as you serve the Lord. Be happy in your hope. Stand your ground when you're in trouble and devote yourselves to prayer. Contribute to the needs of God's people. And this is how it ends: welcome lonely strangers into your home. Brothers and sisters, let us cling to that verse and let us be the church for the lonely. Let us be a place of fellowship and connection for the lonely. And for those of you especially today who need to hear it again, let us remember the promise and cling to the promise of Psalm 68, verse 6, that God will set the lonely in families. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen.